Good afternoon, everybody. Yeah, I never expected that this day would come like this, where I'd be talking about my brother. Because what happened was so sudden that still it has not sunk in for me that my brother is not there. But the fact of life is that the moment you are born, the only certainty in life is death. There's nothing beyond that. All the things that happen between life and death is what a person finally matters and amounts to. And my brother, who is 3 years younger to me, I think made that difference as a human being. That's what is very important, and that's what everybody needs to understand. Our journey as journalists, Girish and Niranjan, that's my brother and me, there were two journalists. One was the journalist, and another was a journalist, or is a journalist. He was the journalist. Girish Nikam was the journalist. I'll come to it a little later as to why I call him the journalist. Girish, as I told you, is 3 years younger to me. And I was supposed to be the smarter guy. Let me tell you that. When we were growing up, I was supposed to be the smarter guy between him and me. Because as we were growing up, it was me who used to get ranks and did pretty well up to 10th standard. Then I failed in PUC. Then I did my graduation. And then I did my MA in philosophy. But Girish was one guy who was very clear and focused in what he did. He had no confusion. He was an epileptic. You know what epilepsy is? You don't know what epilepsy is? Epilepsy is an attack where, you know, what do you tell in Hindi? Epilepsy. Lakwa paralysis hai. Lakwa nahi hai.
Wo
jo shape body sab shape hota hai. So he was an epileptic. You know, I was the first one to see the attack that happened when he was just about 10 or 11. And from that time, he was very clear from the beginning that all his friends were very intelligent. His classmates were very intelligent. They all took science, they all did engineering, they all did medicine. But this guy said, no, I'm not going to do that because that's not my cup of tea. And he did arts. Then when he went to graduation, he did his graduation in economics, journalism, and one other subject, I forget. Anyway, three subjects he did. He did journalism. From there, and he was a second class student too. He was not a first class student. As I told you, I thought I was the smarter guy. I used to get first classes and ranks and all that, but he was always a second class student. Never bothered. Because those days there was no pressure. The parents didn't put pressure on you. And one reason was because we come from a business family. We had a business. My father was there who used to run a handicraft business. That was the business of our family. So my father had a small, very small shop. He had his own philosophy of life. He always said that small is beautiful. And then he had the shops where I would go and sit most of the times. And my brother, he would play cricket. He was a very good cricketer. People would call him Charlie Griffith because he was a good fast bowler. And then he did this graduation. Then he went to Tata Institute of Social Sciences, where he did criminology. He didn't do journalism there. Then he did his master's from Tata. Again, it's not easy to get into Tata Institute of Social Sciences. Here he was who went and wrote the exam, and we were all thinking, a second class student, how will he get into an elite institution, a premier institution like Tata Institute of Social Sciences? He did. He did his criminology there. Then he came back. Then he told my father that he wanted to do law. Then my father said, my wife, Dr. Pamela Sanath, so my father said, I can't support you anymore. This is all that I can do. Then he got upset. He ran away from home. My brother ran away from home. And then I was more than being upset, I was angry. The reason was my mother, she was obviously upset. The reason she was upset for not just because that he ran away, because he had epilepsy, because he used to take treatment. So she was more worried about what would happen to him. What is this guy he has done? He just ran away for quite some time. He disappeared. And just about the time when we wanted to give an ad in the newspaper, this guy comes back. So then what happens? He takes up a job. That is his journalism career of Dickens in Mysore. We have a very good newspaper in Mysore called the Star of Mysore. It is a 40-year-old newspaper now. And just then it had started. In 78, the newspaper had started. So finally he walks into this office of the Star of Mysore, where there was a very mercurial editor. Even today is there, extremely good. And it is the only newspaper in the world, I can tell you. It is an evening newspaper. You can just Google it, Star of Mysore. It is the only newspaper in the world that is distributed at home like a newspaper. Newspapers are distributed in the morning. So Girish goes and joins this newspaper. He goes and talks to the editor. Then his journalism career begins there because he had a degree in journalism. So that's the reason why he went, and he does some very good work there. From there, his life moves on. Then he comes to the mainstream paper. He joins Indian Express in Mysore. From there, he moves to Bangalore. And Girish, the good thing that happened was he is a political analyst. I'm sure when he came and spoke to you, talked a lot about politics and all that. He was a political animal. He knew a lot about politics. The reason was that there was this person in Mysore who was a congressman those days, who was in the earlier in many parties, but he was our neighbor, who was a good friend, family friend. So he used to spend time with that person. And he learned politics from him. He understood politics from him. So his focus was completely politics. He was a reporter. So politics is something that he enjoyed. And then he went to Bangalore there, where he got lucky, met some of the finest people in the newspaper industry, and they all nurtured him. So that's how his career was growing slowly. But again, Girish was one person who was a rebel at every step. He never cared for, you know, the establishment, all those things. He never cared. He was very, as I told you from the beginning, he was very focused in what he was doing. As I was telling Professor Mahanti, Mahanti is also a journalist of that mould. And, you know, I call them terrorists. As journalists, there are terrorists. I would call them that. Because the commitment they have in that sense, because they don't accept anything else. It's only journalism. It's only the work that they are doing. It's the focus that they have. So my brother was like that, an extraordinary fellow in many ways. And so after that, he joined India Today. He was there in Madras for 2 years. Then something happened. Challenges also as journalists, what all we face in India Today, what he faced. Because when the interview came, I think it was Prabhu Chawla who came and interviewed him. And he was, he was taken for a ride because the salary that he accepted, then he realized that people in Delhi were being paid that much more. Those days, I'm talking about almost 25 years ago, 90s. I think he joined India Today in 92. And then it was the magazine of the country. And the editor, Arun Puri, would say, I believe, I don't care if people don't read, but the India Today is there in everybody's drawing room. That was the arrogance that Arun Puri had, isn't it? So my brother joined, and then he was there, and the salary that he got, he realized that he was taken for a ride, sort of. Because, see, small town people, we don't have these kind of things. We're all small town people. I come from Mysore. I don't know, many of you must also be from, you know, especially if you're not in Delhi and you don't understand all these kind of politics, the you know, all the dadagiri and all the kinds of nonsense that happens here in Delhi. We are not like that. We are very simple people. We are sadha people. So we as Manti was talking about Girish and how if you have to be a journalist, how you have to have passion for it. I have two things about it. One is there are three noble professions according to me. One is teaching, That second is medicine, and the third is journalism. Why do I say they are three noble professions? Of course, every profession is noble is a different thing. But why do I call these noble professions? Because they are all people-centered professions. Okay? Because you are directly, as a teacher, you mold the minds of the students. As a doctor, you touch the people, and as a doctor, a patient needs to have confidence in them. As journalists, what we tell matters. Because things can change. You can destroy or make people's lives. But unfortunately, just because we think like that, that we can make or mar people's lives, we become arrogant. That is the problem of being a journalist. But it's a noble profession in that sense that you can mold lives also. So these are the three noble professions according to me. And I also say that there are three professions where you don't need a background. One is acting. You don't need a background. Anybody can become an actor, isn't it? Some pretty face here, suppose somebody sees you and say, okay, can come, give you a break, then they can become an actor. You don't need to go to FTII and all that all the time. The second is politics. Anybody can become a politician. If Rabri Devi could become the chief minister of Bihar, anybody can become, isn't it? So anybody can become a politician. You don't need a background. You don't necessarily need to come from the dynastic families. Of course, now that is the trend that people are, you know, from the dynastic families and all that, but you still have a chance to become a politician where you don't need a background. Third is journalism. Why do I say, in spite of you all studying journalism, I say you don't need a background of journalism. I don't have a degree in journalism. I became a journalist. So I became a journalist at the age of 40. I was a businessman, as I told you, with my father. But when Girish became a journalist, somehow, I don't know, I never imagined in my life that I would come to this profession. But I always had something at the back of my mind that I could also be a journalist. I could write. Because, see, those days there was no television in the first place when we started. Of course, I didn't start like today. I'm 62. I'll be 62 next month. But when I started at the age of 40, it was 95. Still, you know, television was just then coming in. It was mostly print. Somehow I had a feeling that I could write. And then I became a journalist at the age of 40. Why do I tell this? Because in life, there are so many challenges that could come. So, and as my brother kept telling, you have to reinvent yourself every time. And that is what gave me the confidence, because I was a bulletin editor of a Rotary Club where I was the member. Then I started writing there, and people started liking. And there came a time in my life where, you know, a lot of things were not going right. And I told my father, I'm not interested in being with you anymore. We'll sell the business. My father said, we have to sell the business. I said, okay, go ahead and sell it. My father sold the business, but I didn't know what I would do. And because I was, the editor in this small bulletin that we were doing, I walked into the same Star of Mysore office where Giri started his career. And the editor, we knew, because Mysore is a small place where literally everybody knows everybody. And so I walked into the office and told my editor, look, I would like to, because the reason was that this Star of Mysore, like, it keeps advertising all the time that they need a journalist. So I just walked in and told him that I would like to be a journalist. I knew him very well, because my brother started his career there. So I knew him from those days. Then he told me only one thing: when do you want to start? I said, anytime, sir, I'm free. Then he said, what happened was, two people had died in Mysore at that time, prominent people. So my editor asked me, can you do an obituary on them? I said, okay, sir. He asked me how much time you need. I said, maybe 2-3 days. Then the editor, I will never forget those words. He said, look, tomorrow I want it. Because in journalism, any news is like fish. It starts stinking from the second day. So luckily, because I am a Mysorean, I knew people. I just went to these two houses and got the lowdown on both. The one was a doctor, another was a businessman. Then the first article I wrote, the obituary is the one that I wrote. I got a full page. It was it's not a broadsheet, it's a tabloid. Star of Mysore is a tabloid. But I got a full page. That's how my journalism career started, writing an obituary. So Girish parallelly was growing. You know, I was watching him, and I would go to Bangalore, because since he was in Bangalore, I go to the press club, and many a times he would take me to the press club, and there were all these journalists. Those days there were a lot more journalists in the press club than nowadays in Bangalore. Real good journalists, you know, they were all very distinguished journalists. They would all come there. Most of the journalists there, see there. I must tell you this. When we were in a house in Mysore, the owner of that house, so he came to know that Girish was going to be a journalist. My father told him, look, he has gone. Then he said, why do you want to send him to this field? It's not good. You know, the people, journalists, they become drunkards. They you know, that's all they do. Most of the times they drink, they don't do anything much. Why are you encouraging him to be a journalist? So that was the repetition that most of the journalists had, which was also true. It's not that it was not true. People came and drank, and you know, they, in Bangalore Press Club, I used to see that the journalists would come at 11 o'clock in the morning. They would be playing cards. It's not the regular journalists I'm talking about, because a press club has everybody. We have all the yellow journalists. Everybody is there, so everybody gathers. So you have all these people there, and then, but I would go in the evening sometimes with my brother and see. Then I would always joke with him. I think there needs to be a paper to write about you journalists only. I would like to bring out a paper about journalists. Because, see, as I told you, this is a profession which gives you a kick. I always say that, you know, I can go and rape the president of US, of course, not Trump, maybe Obama. But, you know, so I have that the courage when I go. But unfortunately, I can't, as Girish was telling about the management, I can't do a thing about the management. I can't talk to the management if I have any problems. Are there any stories about journalists' problems? Who are there to talk about our problems? There are no stories. We can't write our own problems. Where do we write? Only the other day I saw in Times of India about the problems, about Times of India writing that, you know, we have got this, what is that new scale that has come and it is bleeding us and all kinds of nonsense. The management side they wrote. But what about the other, our side? There's nobody to listen, nobody to care. But here we are, you know, we are very proud that we have interviewed that guy, we have written the story, wo tum padho mera, ko tum padhe ho mai kya likha ho, wo itna acha hai. Doesn't, the world is not just that. So that we live sometimes under an illusion that we are the best. But as Girish said, the challenges are always there. So we have to overcome all these egos, and then only you can become a good journalist. Only if you overcome egos, then only that idea that, okay, I'm doing something. As I told you, unless you have a passion for this field, as even to some Mayanti, I believe, keeps telling, you should not come to this field. You should have passion. Otherwise, there's no point in. And that's what, at the age of 40, I became a journalist. And then my career really took off, because unlike my brother, I never delved into politics. Because politics, I thought, is not my cup of tea. I can't, you know, because that was a completely, especially the politicians that you need to interact, you need to have a different mindset. And my brother had it. He could study, he could do everything, he could analyze. And he was one of the most respected journalists in the country. Now, because he's not there, I can talk about it with a great deal of pride. The very fact that Rajya Sabha Television, he was an employee of Rajya Sabha Television. He was not he was not the vice president, or he was not some CEO or somebody like that. But I don't know how many of you have seen the tribute that you know, the Rajya Sabha paid to him. The tribute was his body was brought to the Rajya Sabha office. That is the tribute. That is the level that he reached at the age of 58. Lot was expected of him. But here was my brother's body lying in the Rajya Sabha Television office, where the top people in the country, irrespective of the party, came to pay homage to him, irrespective of many of them bureaucrats, you know, people from all walks of life came, and there was not a dry eye that day. Everybody was crying. So that was my brother, and that is the level he reached, a small town boy from Mysore, a boy who had epilepsy. And then once he had a surgery of the spine. I did not even know that he had a surgery of the spine. Only much later, years later, he told me that he had the surgery. The kind of sacrifices he did for his friends, for his family, and he would never show off. I can talk about my brother with a great deal of pride, because he achieved that. Now he's not there. Only when, somebody has achieved. You can't just put somebody on the pedestal just like that. Just because you have scored a century. I always compare life to cricket. Because just like cricket, you can't take anything for granted. T20 yesterday we lost badly. And we had beaten England hollow. But yesterday we lost badly. So life is always like that. The moment you think you are on the top, suddenly something happens and you come down. Here I was very happy that I was finishing my assignment with the University of Mysore, the centenary celebrations where I was the consultant. I had reached the height. This is an assignment which comes once in a lifetime and not to everybody. And I got this chance after I retired from Deccan Herald. I got this assignment as the centenary consultant, where we had the president, the prime minister, the vice president coming to our inauguration, the Indian Science Congress that happened, and the valedictory function. Three constitutional heads coming to a university which is about 2,500 kilometers away. Just to get somebody there is a real task. But why? How did this happen? My brother helped me. I was very sure, because my brother is in Delhi, he will help me. So that's how we were able to get the vice president to Mysore. The letter we got initially was that they refused, because that's what happens when you invite somebody big. Then the initial response is, no, we are busy, we can't come. But because my brother was there, I managed to get the vice president. Now, how did my brother get so much of things, so much of influence? How did he command without showing off? That is the character that somebody needs to build throughout their lives. It is not a one-day thing. My brother came to Delhi in 94, 95 he came to Delhi, 21 years ago. And he had to struggle at every step. Every step he had to struggle. There was no, especially people from South come, it's a huge, completely a different thing. The language is different, the culture is different. Then you have to come and adjust here, settle down. So many people who get jobs in, suppose they get in Delhi, nobody wants to come to Delhi. No Southie wants to come to Delhi most of the times. You hardly find journalists from Karnataka here, except the top who are there in Delhi now. People just can't come and adjust here. So here was my brother who did it, with all those struggles, he did it. Finally, he reached the moment he came and joined News Time. News Time was the newspaper from Andhra Pradesh. What is the Telugu one? News Time. Inadu television is there, Inadu newspaper. So he was, he had joined News Time. Then from there, he gave up. After some time, he said, no, this is not working. This is not the care thing for me. He gave up. He freelanced for some time. As he said, if you are good in your profession, you don't need to really worry. Something or the other will keep coming your way. But you have to have your confidence in that. And all of you are youngsters who are into television now. That's a different ball game altogether. Television is a different ball game. I don't have much experience or any experience in television. But what did my brother do? When he joined Inadu, he had helped set up many of the studios in different parts of the country. He recruited people. The boss of Inadu then had great confidence in my brother. So he would go and ask him to pick up people. He would do it. So he had that little by little, the television background he got. And then he was doing something here and there. And finally, he landed in Rajya Sabha television. And he set up that. I didn't know this. I didn't know, for instance, that Girish had taught here for 5 years, from 2004 to 2009. I didn't know that. Only from Mohanty I came. I knew that he was teaching. I knew that he had taught in Jagran, but I didn't know that he had taught for 5 years. I didn't know that. Because as brothers, though we were very close, there were certain things we just, he led his life, I led my life. Only when the things were, either things were too bad or things were very hunky-dory, we would share. Otherwise, he would continue with his life, I would continue. Only if there's a problem, I'm there for him. If there's a problem, he is there for me. So that's how the relationship was between my two brothers. Because these are all, why I'm sharing all this? Because it is human relations that finally matter. And there are, I have seen many families where brothers don't get along, brother, sister, girls don't get along. The day before yesterday, one of my friends, a lady friend, was telling me that, her mother is there in one house and there is another house that she is living. She said, I can't live with my mother. There's no way I can live with my mother. So I am living separately. So all these things are there. And life is not just some job, some money, some this thing. You need to have a perspective about life. And where does it come from? All the experiences that we have, all the experiences that we need every moment. As I told you, I did not want to have this day where I would come and talk about my brother. Maybe I would have been happy if my brother was here and I would have come and met Mohanty and said, oh, give me a chance to talk. Not about my brother, but about something else. But this is also an experience. These are precious moments in our lives. And I have to, you know, understand what this is, this moment, and enjoy it. I should not think too much in the future and say, look, what is, now I'm going back. I don't know what I'm going to do next. I finished with this assignment. I'm going back to Mysore. I don't know what I'll do next. As journalists, the worst thing, the challenges the journalists face, what are the challenges? The main thing is you don't have a pension. The country has not geared up for any of those things. As we grow older, what are we going to do? Monty was talking about his own problem, what he has to do, what he has to do, this thing. All of us, Girish was not sure, because his tenure with the Rajya Sabha probably ending this year, probably in March, May. Then we were wondering, what are you going to do that you are... Then he said, no, something will happen. For me, I don't know what, when I go back, what I'll do. Something will happen. Since you are choosing a profession which is very uncertain, otherwise you can, you know, write an exam, take up IAS, do something where once you get a job, lifetime, you're safe, more or less safe. But here in this profession, it is very, very risky. When I was working for Deccan, I must share this with you. Because Girish told that, somebody asked a question that you don't, what happens if the establishment is not supporting you and many of the things that they say that you can't handle. Then he said, you have to give up and look for another thing. When I was with Deccan Herald, then this newspaper, Deccan Chronicle, started in Bangalore. It came to Bangalore. And then because the salaries were pretty better than in Deccan Herald at that time when this newspaper started, they started giving handsome and fancy salaries. So my brother knew the resident editor of Deccan Chronicle. And then he said, look, my brother is there. Then she said, send him. Then I went, I joined Deccan Chronicle, and the salary was double the salary I was getting in Deccan Chronicle. The moment I entered the Deccan Chronicle office, I said, I have made a mistake. I immediately realized this is not the people for me. The culture, everything was totally different. Third day, I say, I'm not going to work. And I'll go back. I told the Deccan Chronicle people, if that doesn't suit me, maybe I'll come back. You have to give me that opportunity. And the third day, I find that the Deccan Chronicle is not for. The moment I enter, I realized I made a mistake. Then it so happened that the resident editor, somehow because of that, she had a grudge against me. She made my life miserable. This happened because we were almost of the same age, and I myself was 50 plus. I was 55, 53, 54, 55. Right? 2006, I was 55. No, 51, 52. I don't know, something anyway. I was in my mid-50s. And here was this lady trying to undermine my confidence. I had also some, you know, as a Star of Mysore journalist, I had interviewed some of the biggest celebrities that anybody can think of. I had interviewed Rekha, I had interviewed Amir Khan, I had interviewed Kabir Bedi, I had interviewed Anupam Kher. These were the celebrities. Imagine interviewing Rekha, imagine interviewing Amir Khan in a small place like Mysore. And I had developed immense confidence in myself, my abilities to write and everything. And suddenly when I go to this place, this lady, because she had a grudge, she started harassing me. For the first time in my life, I was facing harassment wherever I went. See, unlike my brother, who was a reporter, this I must also tell you, he was a reporter. I was a desk man. You know the difference? Yeah. So I was a desk man. Basically, I was a desk man. But why? Because I was interested in writing. Even though I was a desk man, I wrote. I went out of my way to the people, request people in the establishment and my bosses and tell that I would like to interview this person, that person. I got an opportunity to write. I was not just a desk person. I was not there who was just editing copies and finishing it. Because in Deccan Herald, mornings will be free, afternoon we go. So in my spare time, I would always go and do something else. I would go and write. I would go and meet people. The desk people, nobody knows the desk people. Who knows the desk people? I'm sure in television, it's the same thing. All the other things that they monitor, nobody knows them. It's only the stars, the anchors that are known. But the real job is done by the people around who make you the star. But I decided I'm not going to just be a testman. I'm going to write. Because Star of Mysore, the best thing about a local newspaper is you get to do everything. And once what happened was I was in a paper called Vijay Times, where, you know, I also love to do sports. So I went and tried to interview a person. And there was this sports desk. That man got so upset. He said, angry. I didn't know this. These equations, you know, that everybody has their own things, that everything is compartmentalized. And you have to, once you are this, you can't enter into another territory. All those things were there in a big newspaper. Whereas in a small newspaper, you could do anything. I could write, there were anybody who came to Mysore, I'd interview. I'm doing it again now. My latest, this thing was, I interviewed the Dalai Lama in Mysore. He was given the honorary doctorate. And it is not just interviewing. How do you get to interview a person? Is the story behind the story. How do you, for instance, the Dalai Lama, the latest, who is a Nobel laureate, Mysore University gave him the honorary doctorate. He came to Mysore. Then my editor suddenly calls me. He says, Niranjan, can you go and interview Dalai Lama? And I was really busy with my assignment, with the centenary consultant job that I had, but the passion in me. I said, okay, so once the editor says something, I never say no to him. I said, give me a chance, sir, let me try. So I call people, somehow I get lucky, and to get to Dalai Lama, you have layers of security. You have to get permission, you have to get to the right kind of people, you have to go and talk to them, you have to impress them. All these things will happen in these things. So how did I get the Dalai Lama? And there I was with the Dalai Lama, the ultimate. It is the ultimate experience of my life so far. You can't have a bigger picture than having a Dalai Lama. Of course, I heard that Mohanty also interviewed him about 25 years ago in Dharamsala. But for me, as a small town guy, I had to convince them, say, look, this is the newspaper. It has been there for 40 years. It is distributed at home and all these things. I convinced the lower, these aides. Then finally, I got the interview with Dalai Lama. They gave me only 20 minutes. I go to Dalai Lama, he said, I'll give you 40 minutes. And here I was interviewing with Dalai Lama sitting next to him. I have it in my mobile. I still have it. I showed it to Mohanty. So here I was. And then they told me that Dalai Lama enjoyed my interview as much as I enjoyed interviewing. His aides told me, one of his aides, who is a guy from England who covers all his programs from date, he maintains a personal diary of Dalai Lama. People who come and meet, so he told me, Dalai Lama enjoyed these moments. So what more do you want? At 62, you still have this passion for doing things. That I go, I try to get an interview with Dalai Lama, the efforts that go behind it. These are the things in life, the challenges in life that we always face, and you should not give up. Till the last breath, my brother, what was his last program? It was on the freedom of the press. I have still not seen that. I just can't accept that he's not there. I've still not seen that program, that half an hour program, freedom of the press, which he did on NDTV. A government channel doing a program about a private channel. Unless you have guts, you can't do it. That is the values and the ethics and the things that we all have to stand for. Otherwise, what is life? So you're all very young and, I love youngsters. I requested Mohanty more than he requested me. The reason why I wanted to be here today was my brother. And I thought, what was he doing? What was the things? I wanted to experience this atmosphere that my brother had come. And I believe he also, when the institute started, he was there from then. So, and as I told you, my brother shared nothing with me much. He never spoke about all his achievements, nothing. He would just keep quiet. He would quietly do things. He would just make a call. He would just advise me, no, you don't have to go to this politician for this to get the vice president. You just have to go to somebody else. So that was the kind of guy he was. And, so that was my brother. And this is me. And why do I call him the journalist? Because he was an extraordinary journalist. Why do I call myself a journalist? Because I came to this profession by chance. As I told you, anybody can become a journalist. And here I was, I became a journalist by chance. And I did not reach the level that Girish has reached. But of course, I have my own influence in Mysore. People like me. So it is nice. You know, you feel good that you're wanted. People call you. In a place like Mysore, you become the chief guest of many functions because people are reading you and they think that you have something to offer. So now just I got a call that I have to come for the Republic Day function. It's nice. It's good. But I have reached a stage where those things don't affect me personally. You know, like I don't have to feel, oh, look, I'm a big man now. I've grown and I've done so much of work. So that's the reason why people have to be humbled at every step. Every step I need to be. It's a humbling experience. The higher you go, the more humble you have to become. That is the lesson that Girish gave to everybody. And that is the lesson I have always imbibed. The moment you become egoistic, the moment you think that you are the big guy, I think the ground will just break one day. And my brother was that till his last breath. What was his last program, as I told you? Freedom of the press. He comes out, then he knows. I know that he knew that he had a problem. He calls, he's admitted to the hospital. He's not there. That's the best way to go. As I told you in the beginning, the moment you are born, the only certainty is death, isn't it? There is nothing. It's as much as a mathematical certainty as 2 plus 2 is 4. Death is inevitable, unavoidable. And once we accept that, then we have to celebrate people's lives if they have done well. So that is the reason why I thought I should come and share these things with you about my brother, about me. And, you know, thank you, Mohanty, for giving me this opportunity to be here. And as he said, we have to catch a flight, but I said, I don't want to miss this. Of course, there's still quite some time for us. So the moment Mohanty gave me this opportunity, and, you know, of course, my brother had a lot of books. I've carried a lot of them back, but we have donated some books to your
two cartons full of books. We will put the stamp on Girish Nikam's name and then put it in the library.
Yeah.
We'll just put it together. Two big cartons books have been given by Niranjan and his wife Pam. And we would ensure that students continue to read them as Girish legacy to Jargon Institute.
I think before I close, do you all read newspapers? Yes. Did you read Shahrukh Khan's article in Indian Express?
Not today,
but this was on Wednesday. This was on Wednesday. Why no Indian Meryl Streep? The questions he has raised, I think everybody, especially as TV journalists, you need to read this. And as print journalists, you need to read this. I want all of you to read this. By Shahrukh Khan, nobody else. Okay.
And there's Khan had given an interview to the Indian Express, and they have taken out that specific portion. Why is it? You know what happened? The title of this is why there is no Indian Meryl Streep. You know about Meryl Streep? You know about Meryl Streep, who, while receiving the award, made a strong critique of Donald Trump and said Donald Trump is a curse for United States of America. And the question that was asked to Shahrukh Khan was, why isn't any Indian actor ever coming up with that strong sense of commitment to make a critique of the powers that be? Then he gives an answer. And that answer they have now taken. The fuller interview appeared yesterday. It will appear on Sunday, on 29th. They have taken the extract and published in the...
So this is a good lesson for the journalists to read this. And one more article yesterday. This is by Gopal Krishna Gandhi. This is, heed this 67-year-old tryst. He writes an open letter to the Prime Minister. Okay. Gopal Krishna Gandhi, I'll just tell a little about him and then finish. Because, Gopal Krishna Gandhi, as you all know, is the grandson of Mahatma Gandhi. And he's also the grandson of Rajgopalachari. I don't know how many of you know Rajgopalachari. He was the first Governor General of the country. Okay, and Gandhi and Rajgopalachari became sambandhis because Gandhi's son married Rajgopalachari's daughter. And so this Gopal Krishna Gandhi is from Dakta, the son of Gandhi. And he was the former governor of Bengal. And the Mysore University gave him an award, which is called the Bharat Ratna Centenary Dr. S. Radhakrishnan Award for Social Sciences. So I had the privilege of interacting with Gopal Krishna Gandhi, a brilliant, brilliant piece, which everybody should need to understand, especially as journalists. Because, the kind of things that are happening out is the reality. Again, it all depends on the perception to which, I don't want to talk politics because that's not my, as I told you in the beginning, confess that it's not my cup of tea. But now that my brother is not there, now I think I'll also try to understand politics that much better now that it is there. So I all of you must read this Gopal Krishna Gandhi's article in Hindu, yesterday's one. So thank you all once again for this patient hearing. I hope you have got something out of it. Thank you, sir.
Would you like to ask any question to Niranjan? Anyone?
One question I would like to ask. As you said, sir, there is no today's scenario.
Sir, pitches in fact.
Yes, sir. As you said, that in today's scenario, there is no need to, if you want to become a journalist, so there is no need to be taking any professional training and such kind of thing. But in today's scenario, is it possible?
No, again, see, in television, I agree with you, because unless you have, again, it all depends on luck. See, as my brother was not a television journalist, he was setting up the Rajya Sabha television, then they asked him to take it up. He was initially very uncomfortable, then he became an expert. So he learnt on the job. It all depends on luck finally, you know. Like, I never expected that I would be a journalist, but I became a journalist. Luck also plays a large part. The many people that all the celebrities that I interviewed, one common factor that ran was they said, we are lucky. Nobody, again, you know, most of them were very humble. They are achievers. But all of them, one common factor was, you need to have luck. So when you have luck, something could happen. But definitely you need training. At least when I joined, then I learned everything on my own. It's not that I just came and then wrote and everything happened. I had to learn. I had to learn from mistakes. Only when you commit mistakes do you learn. So similarly, I'm not belittling what you are doing. I definitely, you know, this is a very good ground, and Jagran is doing a fantastic job training journalists and giving opportunities. That's absolutely fine. But I am also telling, the reason why I told this is, you have to, now today you're a journalist. Like, I got this opportunity to be the centenary consultant. Why did I get that opportunity? At the age of 60, 59. Why did I get that? Because of the background in journalism. Now, because this was something that came in my way, I grabbed it. And for 2.5 years, I enjoyed it. It was a different thing that I was doing. I was not doing journalism. I was doing, you know, giving ideas, doing so many things. And my journalism background helped me. Finally, it helped me to write. I've edited 4 books. Edited 4 books as a centenary consultant because of my background. So something else. So what you need to understand is, this is good. You have to have training. You have to have that. But constantly you have to keep thinking what is next. But don't allow that to impede what you are doing. Agar aage sochte rahenge to ye kuch bhi nahi kar sakte. Lekin you have to be mentally ready for everything all the time. You have to be mentally alert. I lost my brother. Now what can I do about it? All I can do is grieve. I wish, you know, like I had finished this assignment. I wanted to come and spend time with him. We wanted to go to Agra, Jaipur, all these places. It didn't happen. Now what I have to move forward. So similarly, when you're doing something here, agar kuch hote jyada, so you have to learn that. But training is very important. TV, in TV, if you don't have training, you can't handle anything. It's a fact. Training is good, but things have changed a lot now. But still, in spite of all that, still if you get an opportunity to do something new, which you feel you don't enjoy something for some time, just for the sake of doing something, you don't need to do.
So, one question I would like to ask, that for a budding journalist, what points need to be concerned, as you think?
See, as I told you, I never became a budding journalist. I started at the age of 40.
For us?
No, I'm just telling you. So what you need to do, unless you have, now are you a print journalist or a
going? Print journalist.
No, print journalist. You are my cup of tea. I yeah. So what, no, how much do you read? कितना पढ़ते हो तुम, कितना अखबार पढ़ते हो, कितना मैगजीन्स पढ़ते हो, कितना किताब पढ़ते हो?
Yes, sir.
The more you read, the better your writing becomes. What, at the age of, when I started my journalism career, when I wrote, to what I write today, the difference you need to find. You have to be happy with what you have done. When I look back at the issues that I did long ago, some of them were good, but now my writing style has completely changed over the years, in this 20 years. So you have to evolve. In English, you have to evolve as a human being. You have to become better and better. So for a budding journalist, he has to see that first he equips himself. Patnaik, as you are, especially as a print journalist, you need to learn a lot more, because we have time. You have time to read this. You have time to read Shah Rukh Khan. Whereas as a television journalist, most of it is bunkum as far as I am concerned that is happening today. The reality you see is not the reality that is there. The scenes that you see on television, most of the times it's not true. So for them, that the challenge is different. How true you are to the profession as a television person, and how true you are to the this thing as a print journalist. So you have to read. That is my only thing. My brother and I, we always said read. It's a tough task nowadays, because jab hum chote hote to we did not have any distractions. There was no television. By the time the television came, because we are all in our 20s. Real television we saw, and that too when Doordarshan started. Just yesterday we were discussing, it was black and white television. 6 o'clock in the morning the channel would start, 10 o'clock it would close, afternoon for 2 hours it would happen, again it would start at 5 or 6 o'clock, 10 o'clock or 11 o'clock it would be over. We had time to read, but now you have so many challenges. You have mobiles, you have television, you have all kinds of nonsense around you. So I feel as youngsters you have that much more challenges than we had when we were growing up.
Yes, thank you.
Any other question? Come. You'll hear a word of that.
So, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nikam.
Just a second. I'm sorry, I forgot one thing. See, this is being streamed live, as Mohanty said. And this is the best tribute that could be paid to my brother on the Facebook. It is being streamed live. Because as Mohanty said, he became a Facebook addict. 24 hours, almost 16 hours would be on the Facebook. And this is being streamed live on Facebook. It's the finest tribute that JIMMC could pay to my brother. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Nikam. And thank you, Mrs. Nikam. And when you people are here today, I remember the face of Mr. Girish Nikam. When I came to JIMMC, he had left. But I remember I have attended a couple of lectures when he came to JIMMC and he spoke on challenges of media. So when you are here today, that memory comes alive. Thank you so much. Thank you for coming today. Thank you.